You can go.
Okay, welcome everybody to virtual ECSS 2020. This is session OPPN 12, cardiovascular physiology and oxygenation. We should have six presenters. I think five of them are currently here in the room. And I only have last names on my sheet. So my apologies when I introduce you all. Please remember that it's 10 minutes of presentation. 5 minutes of questions, and we will have to move on appropriately for all presenters. In that case, we'll get started, and I would like to invite Martinez Canton, who's going to talk to us about post-exercise ischemia. Away you go.
Introduction.
You're now unmuted, so away you go.
Thanks for the introduction. The research is entitled Post-exercise ischemia reveals the role of muscle metabolite accumulation and tissue oxygenation in autophagy activation deactivation in human skeletal muscle. Acute exercise until exhaustion produces several metabolite accumulation, such as RONs, calcium, hydrogen ions, inorganic phosphate, among others. These metabolites are exacerbated under hypoxic conditions, causing oxidative damage, and they are also capable of stimulating signaling pathways essential for the adaptive response to exercise. One of the most important pathways is the autophagy pathway. But what is autophagy? Autophagy is a cellular energy dependent process by which under a cellular stress signal is activated to furnish energy substrates and adjust cellular structures for mitochondrial and protein turnover and for metabolic adaptation and angiogenesis. It's very important to achieve an homeostatic state to avoid detrimental effects on skeletal muscle health. The molecular mechanism triggering autophagy is the following one. Under a cellular stress signal, such as exercise, the ratio of AMP-ATP is increased, activating the main inducer of the autophagy pathway, which is AMPK. AMPK can phosphorylate ULK1 that will disrupt the union of becquerel and BCL2, which is a necessary step for restarting the autophagosome formation. P62, which is recruited by phosphatidylinositol triphosphate, acts as a tagging molecule of ubiquitinated proteins and damaged organelles for the autophagosome degradation. The autophagosome is finally formed by the lipidation of LC3B1 to LC3B2, forming the autophagosome. Finally, lysosome and autophagosome are fused, forming the autolysosome, where, with an acidic environment, will be degraded in amino acids, fatty acids, and nucleotides that will furnish the energy necessary for cellular survival. So, under this stimulus, evidence in mice have shown that exercising can be a potential activator of autophagy, which is necessary to maintain exercise performance and integrity of skeletal muscle cells. However, it remains unknown how exercise, metabolite accumulation, and muscle oxygenation regulate the autophagy pathway in human skeletal muscle. Our aims were to determine whether the principal molecular markers of autophagy pathway are regulated by acute exercise in human skeletal muscle, and also to ascertain whether the different levels in PO2 during exercise influence the autophagic response, as well as the role of muscle oxygenation and metabolite accumulation on the early recovery after exercise. We hypothesized that autophagy signaling could be upregulated by acute exercise, and with this effect more marked in the hypoxia test than in normoxia. And also, we hypothesized that these changes would be reverted two pre-exercise levels within 1 minute of exercisation in the leg recovering with free circulation, while it would increase further in the ischemic leg due to additional accumulation of metabolites and the reduction of PO2 to anoxic levels. To achieve these aims, we perform an incremental exercise to exhaustion in normoxia and hypoxia that allows us to achieve the VO2 max and a high glycolytic high glycolytic metabolism resulting in oxidative stress. Finally, 11 men came to the laboratory and they performed the incremental exercise. And just immediately after the exercise, one leg only was occluded, like we can see in this photo. Several biopsies were taken in the normoxia test, one before exercise, the other one just at the end of the exercise. And finally, a third biopsy from the occluded leg after 1 minute of occlusion. Similar procedures were performed for the hypoxia test. We have a pre-exercise biopsy, a post-exercise biopsy, and finally, a simultaneous bilateral biopsy, one from the occluded leg and the other one from the free circulation or the non-occluded leg. All the biopsies were taken from the muscle vastus lateralis, and the molecular signals were analyzed by Western blot technique. As a result of the experimental protocol, the femoral vein PO2 at the end of the exercise was lower in hypoxia than in normoxia, and muscle metabolite accumulation, nevertheless, muscle metabolite accumulation was similar in hypoxia and normoxia. In the occluded leg, there was an increase of muscle lactate and a decrease of phosphocreatine before exercise. In the non-occluded leg, ATP levels were largely restored after 1 minute of the end of the exercise in this leg, and there was a resynthesis of phosphocreatine. Regarding protein expression, the ratio of the main inducer of the autophagy pathway was increased after incremental exercise and maintained running occlusion. This was followed by an increase of the phosphorylated to total Becklin-1 after exercise, and this effect maintained by the ischemia application, but not in the leg recovering with free circulation. The ratio of phosphorylated to total P62 was increased only after exercise, and this ratio was totally fully recovered to pre-exercise levels only in the leg recovering with free circulation. Despite a non-significant time effect, an increased trend in the ratio of SF3B2 to SF3B1 was found, which was higher in the post than in the pre-exercise biopsies. Finally, several signals correlated with the main inductor in the autophagy pathway, which is AMPK, suggesting a positive modulation of autophagy signaling with exercise to exhaustion and ischemia. As we have seen, the protein expression of markers of autophagy pathway was similar at exhaustion in normoxia and hypoxia, likely due to a similar accumulation of metabolites in both conditions, meaning that the increment in inorganic phosphate and free creatine could be a factor activating autophagy, like the mediated by RONs, and that the additional reduction in cellular PO2 during exercise in hypoxia was not enough to further stimulate autophagy, indicating that this level was already maximal in normoxia test. During ischemia, there was a further increase in glycolytic metabolism. Nevertheless, there was an unchanged expression of the autophagy pathway markers. In contrast, in the contralateral leg, there was a phosphocreatine resynthesis, which returned autophagy phosphorylation levels to pre-exercise levels. This can mean that excessive levels of inorganic phosphate and free creatine during occlusion may inhibit phosphatases, not allowing the dephosphorylation of autophagy markers, maintaining active the autophagic flux. So we can conclude that the autophagy signaling pathway is upregulated by a single boat of exercise to exhaustion to a similar extent in normoxian and severe acute hypoxia. The accumulation of inorganic phosphate due to instantaneous ischemia application during the recovery may maintain the autophagic flux in human skeletal muscle, and these changes are almost completely reverted to pre-exercise levels with a fast turnover in protein expression after a free circulation period of 60 seconds. We have also shown the importance of obtaining fast muscle biopsies during exercise to capture changes with rapid recovery kinetics. And finally, I would like to thank all my lab members and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, and that was perfectly kept at time. Can I ask the assessors if they have any questions?
So I have a few questions, Keith.
Go ahead, Jonathan.
So first of all, thank you very much for a lovely presentation. I just wondered, you know, at the beginning you started with the story of AMPK and autophagy, but I missed the rationale for why you thought different oxygen levels would alter the response.
Oxygen levels like hypoxia and normoxia. Because in hypoxia probably there are it can be more metabolite the accumulation of metabolites can be higher due to higher runs production. That is not the case, but we still don't know why it's not the case. Because of different levels in the PO2.
Okay. And just had a technical question on, so it looks fantastic, you know, the timing of the biopsies, but do you have data on, you know, the deviation around, because, you know, you're taking biopsies with a 1 minute window, what's the standard deviation around each timing?
Between the biopsies?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. The post-exercise biopsy, it was taken 10 seconds just after the end of the exercise, and this was all the experiments were recorded, and we can fully sure that they are in the correct timing. I don't know if that's the question.
So was it 10 plus or minus 1 second or plus or minus 10 seconds?
No, it's 10 seconds, just 10 seconds. They are on time.
Perfect.
Perfect.
I'd be more convinced if you could nothing's perfect, so I'd be more convinced if you could tell me the error around that 10 seconds.
Probably 1 second or 2 seconds, but no, it's... There are not a lot of difference.
Okay. I have other questions, but I'll let others speak.
Okay. Anybody?
I have a question. Very nice presentation, Miriam. A lot of data you presented here. I have a general question. You decided to check the biopsies 1 minute after for the phenomenon that you were investigating, up to 5G. And I just wonder, is that the ideal timing to investigate this phenomenon? This phenomenon is so rapid that that is 1 minute is the ideal time frame to study?
The idea of occlusion. This study was not designed to assess, to study autophagy, and was not the principal main of this study. This study was done, I think, in 212, and was not the main idea to study autophagy with this model.
Okay.
I don't know if I am
answering. Just then, if you would... be able to design this study with a recovery that this idea for the question of your study, will you still use the same 1 minute, or you will study over 1 hour, 2 hours, and 3 hours? What type of protocol will you use?
For ischemia application, probably just 1 minute. But for example, biopsies, we should take biopsies further in time to assess autophagy better, like 2 hours. 2 hours later of the exercise, and 24 hours, for example.
Okay, thank you.
You're on mute, Keith.
How often have we said that over the last couple of weeks, everybody? We have to move on because of time. So thank you very much, Miriam. The second presenter hasn't arrived, so I believe we're going to move on to, is it Victoria Mee? Victoria, are you around? Ah, there we go.
I'm here, yeah.
Thanks, Victoria.
Just share my screen a moment.
Okay, now whenever you're ready, Victoria.
Okay, awesome. Firstly, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to present as part of the Young Investigator Award. My name is Victoria, and today I'll be talking to you about exercise in twin pregnancy. Our recent meta-analyses conclusively demonstrated that regular physical activity in pregnancy has benefits to maternal and infant health. Engaging in 150 minutes of moderate intensity activity per week reduces the risk of complications without increasing the risk of adverse outcomes. There were early concerns that maternal exercise would result in reduced blood flow to the developing baby. However, this is unfounded in empirical research. My recent work demonstrated that maternal cardiac function was similar in non-pregnant and pregnant women. And our recent meta-analysis demonstrated that fetal well-being was maintained during and following maternal exercise. Thus, maternal output and fetal delivery are maintained. This evidence is applicable to single baby pregnancies only. In contrast, women who are pregnant with twins face significant barriers to physical activity. Guidelines from around the world recommend that they cease exercise in late pregnancy. They are often prophylactically prescribed activity restriction or bed rest, and this is because they are considered at higher risk of complications. My recent systematic review challenged these recommendations on the basis there is no evidence of harm of being active. In fact, some case studies and intervention studies that included twins as part of a larger cohort demonstrated benefits. However, there is a desperate need for empirical evidence that addresses the concerns of this population. Our recent survey identified that over a quarter of women were stopped their activity due to concerns of fetal well-being. Therefore, the aim of this study was to investigate the acute maternal and fetal responses to exercise in twin pregnancy. We hypothesized that in comparison to singleton pregnancies, twin pregnancies would have greater resting cardiac output. However, when accounting for this baseline, there would be no difference in maternal responses to exercise between singletons and twins. In all pregnancies, we anticipated that there would be fetal well-being would be maintained following maternal exercise. Excuse me. In this context, a null finding would help us to identify, to show that there is no adverse impact of maternal exercise in twin pregnancy. So I will present data from 10 singleton and 10 twin pregnancies that are part of a larger longitudinal cohort. After medical pre-screening, they completed a 10-minute baseline in which we determined resting heart rate for calculation of heart rate reserve. Participants then completed a submaximal exercise test on a recumbent cycle. This started with a 3-minute warm-up at 25 watts and was followed by 3-minute incremental stages until the participant hit their target of 70% heart rate reserve. The test was then stopped. Prior to, during, and following the exercise test, maternal heart rate and blood pressure were measured continuously using electrocardiography and finger photoplethysmography. Maternal cardiac function was measured using echocardiography at baseline and during the final 90 seconds of each exercise stage. Fetal well-being was measured pre and post-exercise using 2D ultrasound. Maternal rating of perceived exertion was also recorded. Our outcome measures, we specifically looked at maternal heart rate and blood pressure responses, as well as cardiac output. Stroke volume was estimated using the area change from diastole to systole from a four-chamber view, or by using the left ventricular outflow tract velocity time integral from a five-chamber view. To assess fetal well-being, we used the well-established metric of fetal heart rate. Normal fetal heart rate should be between 110 to 160 beats per minute. If we identified a fetal heart rate of lower than 110 beats per minute, this would indicate fetal distress or hypoxia. This is known as fetal bradycardia, and this would obviously be very concerning if we identified this post-exercise in any pregnancy. To address our hypotheses, we used independent samples t-tests to look at the differences between groups at rest, the differences in maternal cardiac responses, specifically the change from baseline to the highest equivalent workload for all participants, and then finally in the changes in weight fetal well-being from pre to post exercise. Our significance was set at 0.05, and data are presented as a mean and standard deviation throughout the rest of this presentation. In terms of our sample, they were matched for gestational age, maternal age, height, and pre-pregnancy BMI. And all women were in their second or third trimester of pregnancy. On to some results. Twin pregnancies did indeed have a greater resting cardiac output and heart rate at rest. There were no significant differences in stroke volume, mean arterial pressure, systemic vascular resistance, or ejection fraction. On to exercise performance. The highest equivalent workload for all participants was 75 watts. And this is considered a moderate to vigorous intensity when looking at maternal heart rate. As you can see from the table, both groups were well matched at this stage. At the end of the test, all women did meet the 70% heart rate reserve target and therefore were exercising at a vigorous intensity. As you can see, the power output was similarly matched between the two groups, and all women reported their exertion as hard or above. As the vigorous intensity is in line with current guidelines for pregnant women. In terms of exercise responses, I'll just take a moment to orientate you to my figures. So we have the yellow circles are singleton pregnancies and the green squares are twin pregnancies. On the y-axis, you'll have the delta change in the parameter and the p-value in the top right corner. So this is actually the figure for the change in mean arterial pressure. And on the right, the change in maternal heart rate. As you can see, the maternal heart rate and blood pressure responses were not different between singleton and twins in response to cycling. On the left, we now have change in cardiac output, and on the right, the change in stroke volume. We suggest that cardiac output and stroke volume may be blunted in twin pregnancies when cycling at 75 watts. This could indicate a lower cardiovascular reserve in this population. However, we would only be concerned about this if we saw downstream negative impact on fetal well-being. So looking at the data from our 10 singleton and 20 twin fetuses, we saw no change in pre to post fetal heart rate between the two groups. This is important because we saw every fetus stayed within their target, their heart rate zone of 110 to 160 beats per minute, and there were no incidences of fetal bradycardia, so a heart rate less than 110. Therefore, fetal well-being was maintained following vigorous intensity exercise in twin pregnancies. In summary, twin pregnancies do have a greater cardiac demand at rest. However, this does not impact their heart rate or blood pressure responses to exercise. Increases in cardiac output may be blunted in this population, and this could have considerations for exercise prescription. However, we do believe that this requires some further investigation. Most importantly, my data show that there are no adverse fetal responses to vigorous exercise in twin pregnancy. These are the first empirical data that show the acute safety of maternal exercise in this population, and they are the critical first step to challenging the barriers and the low levels of physical activity in twins. With the acknowledgement that it's very difficult to recruit twin pregnancies, we do hope that these findings will encourage research into the chronic effects of exercise, as well as development of specific activity guidelines. And at the moment, preventing women with twins from being active could actually be placing them at higher risk of developing complications. So we do really need to improve work in this area so that individuals with twin pregnancies can benefit from being active too. I'd like to say thank you to my participants, to Drs. Davenport and Steinbeck, as well as the rest of the Programme for Pregnancy and Postpartum Health. I'd also like to acknowledge my funders, the Canadian Institute of Health Research, the Women and Children's Health Research Institute, and the Lois Hull Hospital for Women. Thank you very much for listening, and I'd like to invite any questions.
Okay, thank you very much, Victoria, again for the time accuracy there. Maybe I can start off with a couple of questions and invite others. What was the mass change difference between twin and singletons?
In terms of left ventricular mass?
No, total body mass.
Total body mass. So at this stage when they were measured, we identified that there was no significant difference between the two groups. In terms of body mass assessment. However, later in pregnancy, gestational weight gain was greater in the twins versus the singletons.
Okay, so the twins hadn't gained more weight at this particular point in time?
Not at this particular point. So most of the assessments were done kind of early in the second trimester, early third trimester. And why we see that kind of much larger deviation in gestational weight gain is throughout the third trimester with twins. The other thing that I would say is that my population were very active, were very healthy individuals, and may not be quite representative of like the general population, as we always find with individuals who sign up for exercise studies. So we did find that they were kind of quite a unique group of twin pregnancies as well.
Okay, that's useful information. Second one related to fetal stress. Did you manage to collect any heart rate data actually during the exercise?
No, so we planned because there's quite a lot of different measures going on. So in addition to what I've presented today, we also are trying to also collect respiratory data, as well as some lactate and glucose responses. And I'm also trying to do the echo at the same time as they're cycling. So we didn't manage to get any measures actually during the exercise stage. However, as soon as they stop, our clinical collaborator, Dr. Lisa Hornberger, is ready to take the images. So maternal heart rate is still elevated. We do get fetal heart rate, but we also get umbilical uterine blood flow, as well as fetal middle cerebral artery. And these also are different metrics that can help us to describe fetal well-being too. So we do have some additional measures that we are yet to analyze that will help us to give us a whole picture as well.
Okay, thank you, Victoria. Any other questions from the assessors? Justin?
Yes, thank you. So thanks for a very clear presentation. I just had a question about your stats. Actually, I was just wondering why you'd chosen to do t-tests on the delta change and what else you could have done.
Yeah, so our actual plan for this is we do have data at each exercise stage for each participant. So our actual plan is hopefully to do repeated measures and over to look at the differences across each stage between groups. We also think that this will be important. So as I mentioned, that potentially there is a blunting of stroke volume and cardiac output response. So with actually doing repeated measures and over, we'd be able to see if the plateau was different in that increase in stroke volume. At the moment, in all honesty, I think we're underpowered. Well, we are underpowered. We need 22 women to look at that difference in cardiac output specifically per group. So I haven't kind of gone full into the stats right now because I think it would, I want to wait until we have the full data set, if that makes sense.
Okay, yeah. Do you think you have it? Oh, sorry, go on.
One last question. Go ahead.
Okay, I have a question. Just how, what is your prediction in regards to the blood flow responses given the similarities in cardio output between the two groups?
In terms of like the uterine or umbilical blood flow?
Yes.
So we don't anticipate any change. So in singleton pregnancies, we don't see any impact of maternal exercise on umbilical or uterine blood flow in healthy pregnancies. So I'd anticipate that we don't see the same, we don't see anything different in terms of the twin pregnancies too. But yes, it's kind of my, it would be definitely interesting to look at that in kind of line with the differences potentially in maternal cardiac output.
Thank you very much, Victoria, and well done again on timing, but we need to move on, so thank you.
Thank you very much.
I think the next person is Andrea Trifnos. Andrea?
Hi, yes.
How are you?
Yep.
And if you want to share your screen and start whenever you're ready, Andrea.
Did I came?
Yep.
So, good afternoon from me. It's very well organized conference given the circumstances, I could say. And thank you for the introduction. So, this study aimed to assess the impact of catheterization on shear medial dilation in healthy young males. Endothelium is the inner monolayer of the arteries and has been shown to have an important role in the regulation of vascular trauma. Indeed, previous animal studies, which actually aimed to explore the role of endothelium, showed that in arteries where the endothelium was intact, arteries are dilated in a dose-dependent manner in response to incremental exercise, whereas when endothelium was removed, these arteries were constricted in response to increased flow during exercise instead of dilate, reflecting the critical role of endothelium in the regulation of vascular tone. In humans, we might see endothelial dilatation in a diagnostic angiogram and or angioplasty procedure. In fact, when a catheter inserts into the arteries, is likely to mechanically damage endothelial cells, leading to endothelial and dysfunction and further complications. One well-known non-invasive test to measure endothelial function and dysfunction is flow medial dilation, which is basically an assessment of the percentage dilation of arteries in response to increased flow. Recently, our group observed that flow medial dilation was significantly reduced in patients who underwent catheterization, reflecting the impact that catheter may have on endothelial function. However, this study, in addition to all the other evidence we've got in regards to catheterization in tumors, were conducted in coronary artery disease patients where a priori endothelial dysfunction may be apparent. So, we don't know to which extent these FMD responses are dependent upon a healthy endothelium in humans. Therefore, the aim of the study is to assess the radial artery shear medial dilation following categorization in young trained males who have been chosen as a model of endothelium layer is fully functional and healthy. We hypothesized that, that the shear methylation would be abolished following catheterization. So, in this study, 26 healthy young trained males consented to participate, and we asked them to attend the lab in three different occasions. During the first visit, we measured all the anthropometric characteristics, including fitness level, and we also measured the baseline, the pre-catheterization endothelium function, which the test FMD, as we mentioned before. The important is that we've done a bilateral FMD, which means that we that we've done the same test in both arms simultaneously. One supposed to be the catheterized arm, and the other to be as an internal control. To explain a little more about this test, we basically ask the participants to lie down in a supine position, and we put some blood pressure cuffs, like blood pressure cuffs, around the wrist. We then use a Doppler non-invasive ultrasound to scan both radial arteries in the same arch simultaneously. That was the baseline diameter. Then we inflated those cuffs for 5 minutes, and then we released. When we release the cuff, we expect, due to increased flow, the diameter to increase. So the FMD basically is a percentage change from the baseline to the peak when the cuff was released, when the cuffs were released. So during the second visit, we asked trained cardiologists to perform a transradial catheterization to these participants to a single arm. And then we asked them to come back 7 days later to do exactly the same FMD in the same arch to see what happened after the catheterization. Again, it was bilateral FMD. So, what we see is that the FMD in the catheterized arm was significantly reduced in the catheterized arm, whereas no change observed in the control arm. Something that captured our interest, though, is that the FMD in the catheterized arm was completely abolished, meaning negative or zero in 5 participants and less than 1% in further 2 participants, which is something that we didn't see when we did the same study in coronary artery disease patients. In order to determine the local effect of catheterization explore potential factors why these participants have extrajudicular reduction in FMD, we calculated the FMD change in the catheterized arm pre to post catheterization. And then we subtract that from the FMD change in the control arm to find the FMD overall change. And then we see that this FMD overall change was not correlated neither with the baseline diameter of this participant, nor with catheter size or artery to sheath ratio. In addition, there was not associated neither with participants' characteristics such as age, BMI, or fitness level. So, in this study, to the best of our knowledge, is the first and the only one to provide direct evidence of impaired shear mated dilation following arterial damage in young individuals with a fully intact primary endothelial function. We perform similar design studies in 2 simple groups, the coronary artery disease patients and later to a young trained male. So we have the opportunity to go into the individual data. And as you can see here, only young trained males have seen this abortion in FMD following catheterization. In these 2 studies, we've been used exactly the same equipment in terms of ultrasound and software. We also, we are the same sonographers. And we test them exactly on the same day, 7 days post-catheterization. And importantly, in young trained males, we've been used smaller size catheters and arteries were bigger than the coronary artery disease patient. And in addition, we assume that in young trained male, endothelium function was better because of healthier endothelium in contrast to the patient. So we believe that different mechanisms may underline this shear medial dilation between healthy individuals and patients with cardiovascular risk factors. In fact, it's been suggested that shear medial dilation in patients with dysfunctional endothelium, there might be a presence of endothelium-independent mechanisms. Previous studies shown that nitric oxide contribution to FMD might be smaller in cardiovascular in patients with cardiovascular risk factors compared to healthy individuals, which somehow could explain our difference in between the two sample groups. In addition, it is worth noting that all participants in this specific study have a larger arterial diameter than the external diameter of the sheath, and this could somehow explain why we didn't find any association between the FMD change with the artery to sheath ratio or the baseline diameter of the participant. Importantly, we didn't see any associations with participants' characteristics such as BMI, age, or fitness level. And this might be because we've been using a very specific group. All the participants have very similar fitness level, age, and BMI. If we see our study from a clinical perspective, it's been suggested that preoperative exercise training, just because can optimize arterial size and function, it could be used as an intervention to limit the impact of catheterization and improve arterial health in patients post-procedure. However, our current data indicate that perhaps this preoperative exercise-based rehabilitation is unlikely to fully negate the impact of catheterization on arterial function, without, of course, discount all the other benefits that the exercise training may have in these particular patients. So, the take-home message of this specific study is that endothelial contributions to shear medial dilation may be larger in healthy individuals than in subjects with a priori endothelial dysfunction. Thank you for your attention, and of course, thanks to my team that made this study possible.
Thank you very much, Andrea. I'm happy to open for questions from the assessors. I'm going to start with one, and then pass on to everybody else. Can you just explain the process of catheterization that was involved? How long the process took, and what the movement of the catheter within the artery was?
So, basically, we asked the participants to lie down. Then there was a local anesthesia to the participants because it's quite painful to have an arterial catheter in your wrist. And after we achieved local anesthesia and we checked that the flow, that there was a flow into the artery, and we checked that using the ultrasound to make sure that there wasn't any radial occlusion of the process. Because in that case, we would exclude the participants, of course. Then, in terms of catheterization, the sheaths were 16 centimeters length in all participants. And we used 3 or 4 F catheters. Basically, the fold was a bit larger than the 3. However, when we see that, we didn't see any differences in the participants from the function as well. So the sheath was the same, and the FMD was taken after the sheath, not on the sheath, not participants.
Okay, thank you, Andrea. Other question? Other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Good presentation in regard. Do you have an idea of the level of endothelial damage that you get with the insertion of the radial catheter?
Well, it would be very good to have that, but I'm afraid that we don't. If I'd done that study again, I would involve some ultrasound inside in intravascular ultrasound to measure that. So we don't know that. However, we see that in all participants, baseline diameter after the catheterization was significantly reduced in the catheterized arm and not in the control arm, or not in the control arm, which we assume that we have. That's something that we see when there is an endothelial damage. In addition to that, there is a recent study from the University of Edinburgh who measured the damage using ultrasound in coronary artery disease patients. And there was, if I remember correctly, one-fifth of participants of their patients have completely abolished the endothelium layer using the catheterization.
Okay. Just a follow-up question in regards when you compare the coronary artery patients to the younger subject population, you normally have an aging effect on FMD. Are you really making a fair comparison when you compare those two groups?
Well, definitely not. That's why we didn't put in the model. However, we did find this interesting because there was exactly the same design, and the thing is that in coronary artery disease patients, catheters were bigger than that we use in healthy young individuals. So we will assume that we wouldn't have this exaggerated reduction in FMD following catheterization. And in fact, we see worsened results than in coronary artery disease patients. That's why we think that this is something interesting to present.
Thank you.
Okay, Andrea, I'm afraid we are out of time. So thank you very much for your presentation. Well done. And I'd like to invite the next presenter, which is Gavin Travers from Brunel University, who's going to talk to us about heat acclimation and hydration status on left ventricular function. Gavin, I'm assuming you're with us. So if you want to sign on, thank you. Perfect. You can start whenever you're ready, Gavin.
Okay, thank you. So thank you for today. It's great to be here, albeit virtually. Hello, everyone at home. Today, I'm going to be sharing some data from a recently published study investigating the effects of heat acclimation and hydration status on left ventricular volumes and function and systemic hemodynamics during rest and exercise in humans. So the effects of heat acclimation on systemic hemodynamics are quite inconsistent across the literature. So for example, in this study by Birdell Nielsen, they observed that during cardiac continuous load exercise to exhaustion, cardiac output was significantly increased immediately prior to exhaustion following a 10-day protocol. However, elsewhere in the literature, cardiac output is largely unaltered or perhaps even decreases during heat acclimation interventions. And there's similar responses for mean arterial pressure throughout the literature. And this perhaps reflects differences in the intensity or modality of exercise, or perhaps even the type or severity of heat stress investigated, or even perhaps the number of participants in pre and post acclimation conditions, or even their hydration status, which is often not reported or controlled. In fact, the effects of acute exercise-induced dehydration on responses is also unknown. So there's some limited evidence to suggest that mild deficits in body mass during exercise in the heat following acclimation is associated with attenuated increases in heart rate and core and whole body temperature, where more moderate exercise-induced dehydration is limited to studies that investigate hyperhydration. So this is either prior heat stress and fluid restriction or the use of diuretics in this example. And in this paper by Ikegawa et al., they noted that 3% body mass loss following diuretic administration, plasma volume and cardiac output responses were similar during an exercise bout in the heat, whereas stroke volume was significantly lower and heart rate was significantly higher compared to euhydrated controls. However, this isn't necessarily an ecologically valid model of moderate levels of dehydration, and therefore the effects of exercise-induced dehydration to this kind of level is actually unexplored. Generally, heat acclimation is considered to improve cardiovascular stability via a lowering of exercising heart rate and an increase in plasma and therefore total blood volume, so that diastolic filling of the left ventricle or preload is enhanced such that stroke volume may be increased and perhaps also cardiac output. However, in all those studies that I've just mentioned, cardiac output is measured and so is heart rate, while stroke volume is a derived parameter. So while this is mechanistically plausible, we have no direct evidence regarding diastolic or systolic volumes during exercise in heat-acclimated humans. If we also consider the classical models of cardiovascular control, cardiovascular function may also be influenced by the net arterial load or afterload imposed on the heart, as well as perhaps by changes in diastolic or systolic mechanical function of the left ventricle. Therefore, the aim of this study was to determine the effects of heat acclimation and hydration status on left ventricular volumes and function and systemic hemodynamics at rest and during dynamic exercise in the heat. We hypothesized that heat acclimation would increase stroke volume during euhydrated exercise, as well as during exercise with mild levels of dehydration, and be associated with an enhanced blood volume, lowered heart rate, and augmented diastolic filling of the left ventricle. However, with more moderate levels of body mass loss or dehydration, the responses pre and post acclimation would be similar. To do this, we recruited 8 males. They were a mixture of cyclists and triathletes, and they had a relative VO2 max of around 53 milliliters per kilogram. And we conducted the following experimental procedures. So hemoglobin mass was measured in duplicate, before measurements of VO2 max in core conditions during upright and semi-recumbent cycling. And we also determined that participants' pre-acclimation sweat rate. Then 2 experimental trials were conducted in a randomized and counterbalanced order before and after 10 days of exercise heat acclimation with a controlled heart rate for 90 minutes a day. Experimental procedures consisted of several measurements taken at rest and during repeated bouts of semi-recumbent cycling after 20, 100, or 180 minutes of exercise in 33 degrees and 50% relative humidity. And these measurements consisted of determining new body mass and urine-specific gravity, rectal and mean skin temperature, absolute blood, plasma, and red cell volumes, mean arterial pressure, and using echocardiography, left ventricular volumes and function. Between bouts of semi-recumbent cycling, upright cycling was performed on a load ergometer for comfort. And during this time, we provided either 90% of what we expected them to lose as sweat through fluid or only 10%. And this resulted in a 1.8% decrease in pre-exercise body mass after 100 minutes and a 3.6% decrease in pre-exercise body mass after 180 minutes. And this is the average before and after acclimation and was achieved by manipulating fluid intake based on individual changes in sweat rate. And this is what we found. So during the 10 days themselves, so heart rate after the first 15 minutes of each session before control began was 11 beats lower after by day 10. And thereafter, to maintain exercising heart rate at the given target, significant increases in absolute power and total work done occurred over the 10 days. And there was a 13% increase in sweat rate. However, during our experimental trials, rectal temperature was similar pre to post acclimation, so this is pre and post, and was then also unchanged pre to post during semi-recumbent exercise with maintained dehydration, while mean skin temperature was similar throughout trials. In addition, plasma and blood volume were unaltered by the intervention and were also maintained during dehydrated exercise pre and post acclimation. And similarly, during semi-recumbent cycling, heart rate was also similar pre to post acclimation with maintained dehydration. I should say that during upright exercise, heart rate was on average 7 beats lower following acclimation. In contrast with progressive dehydration, rectal temperature progressively increased and was 0.6 degrees higher. Blood volume steadily decreased and was 380 mils lower. And heart rate progressively increased and was 16 beats a minute higher at 180 minutes compared to euhydration both before and after acclimation. Diastolic and systolic left ventricular volumes during euhydrated exercise were unaltered by heat acclimation, although there was a small but statistical difference in stroke volume in euhydration trials following acclimation, but this was only around 7 to 9 mL per beat. And together with the similar heart rate responses, cardiac output was also largely unaltered, and there was a 0.7 litres a minute increase at only 180 minutes following heat acclimation. And again, in contrast, with progressive dehydration, stroke volume progressively declined by around 26 mL per beat and was met with a similar reduction of around 29 milliliters per beat in end-diastolic volume, while end-systolic volume was maintained throughout exercise. And as a result, cardiac output was 2.1 litres a minute lower at 180 minutes compared to euhydrated trials, both before and after acclimation, and was associated with a slight decline in mean arterial pressure. Twist and untwisting of the left ventricle, which are indexes of systolic and diastolic function respectively, were unaltered by heat acclimation. And if anything, in some parameters for systolic function, we noted slight increases with progressive dehydration both before and after heat acclimation. And finally, Pearson's product moment correlations demonstrated similar relationships between a change in end diastolic volume and a change in stroke volume before and after acclimation, as well as for an increase in heart rate and a decline in end diastolic volume, and a decline in blood volume and a decline in end diastolic volume. So in contrast to our hypothesis, diastolic and systolic left ventricular volumes were unaltered following heat acclimation, and this was associated with similar heart rate and blood volumes during exercise. And as such, stroke volume and cardiac output were largely unaltered and accompanied by a slight decline in total peripheral resistance as mean arterial pressure was unchanged. Also, in contrast to some evidence from the rodent model, 10 days of exercise heat acclimation in trained humans did not result in any changes in diastolic or systolic mechanical function during exercise. However, with acute moderate exercise-induced dehydration before and after acclimation, cardiac output and stroke volume were significantly lower. And this was due to a decline in end diastolic filling of the left ventricle, second to elevated heart rate, and a reduction in blood volume as end systolic volume was maintained. And diastolic and systolic function were also maintained or slightly enhanced, respectively. So in conclusion, left ventricular volumes and cardiac output are minimally altered when heart rate and blood volume are similar pre to post acclimation, and that 10 days of exercise and heat acclimation in trained humans does not result in a change in systolic or diastolic function of the left ventricle. However, with acute moderate exercise-induced dehydration beyond 3% of body mass loss, cardiac output is reduced, and this occurs via an impaired diastolic filling of the left ventricle. And therefore, maintaining euhydration is important for promoting diastolic filling of the left ventricle and therefore cardiovascular stability during endurance exercise in the heat, despite undertaking heat acclimation. I just want to say a quick thank you to my supervisors and collaborators, and a huge thank you to my participants. It was quite a big study. Thank you for listening, and lovely to happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Gavin. Nice presentation. Maybe I'll just start with a couple and then pass over. Are you confident that they were acclimated?
Yeah, good question. I was expecting that one. So there's several reasons to suggest that they were, but yeah, that you're right. We don't have every classical marker available. So we did note reductions in heart rate during upright exercise, an increase in sweat rate, and we also noted in another trial, which I haven't reported, an improvement in exercise performance in the heat. But yes, you're right, with a similar core temperature and heart rate, it does appear that they weren't heat acclimated. However, in a lot of the studies in the literature, resting core temperature before acclimation is in relatively fit people and is around about 37.5. So it's quite a scope for a reduction, whereas in our participants, it was about 36.7, 36.8. So it was already quite low. But yeah, I agree with your point there.
Okay. The second one's a technical one related to your point about changes in diastolic function. Mm-hmm. So I guess what you're saying is that there's less filling. I'm sort of interested to know whether that's just a preload issue or whether it's intrinsic diastolic relaxation. Do you have any data that looks at intrinsic diastolic relaxation?
Yes, absolutely. So I believe it's a reduction in end diastolic volume and a reduction in preload. That's because the matched reduction in stroke volume matches the change in end diastolic volume. But we also have data regarding the diastolic strain and strain rates and the untwisting rates, and they were unaltered by progressive dehydration.
Given that diastolic function has a significant longitudinal mechanical element to it, mm-hmm. and twist is probably a little bit more complicated than just longitudinal function. Do you have any longitudinal tissue Doppler data or strain data?
So we did take global longitudinal strain, which was slightly lowered with dehydration. But with the changes in parameters and increases in rates and strains, we still think there's largely it's unaltered. But we did try to take some tissue Dopplers, but we managed to get those at rest, but they proved a bit too difficult during exercise.
Okay, thank you, Gavin. Any other questions?
Yes, I just have a quick question. So, if I understand it correctly, that you were trying to test the effects of heat acclimation. I just wondered, do you think you need a group where they exercised not in the heat?
Yes, as in to control for training, or as in a cool conditions exercise band?
Yeah, to control for training.
Yeah. You're absolutely right there. So there's always that caveat: is how do we know it's the addition of heat stress rather than training? So the participants were fit and healthy. They were active cyclists and triathletes. They were training for over 7 hours a week. And in addition to that performance trial I just mentioned that I didn't report there, we also repeated the VO2 max test in cool conditions, and that didn't increase either. So whilst there is a possible training component doing 90 minutes a day for 10 days in a row, I'm confident that any of the differences that we did see, because they were largely similar, there wasn't actually a training component in the present data. But yeah, you're right, there's certainly a limitation in the literature that doesn't really account for a sudden increase in training load over particularly short-term acclimation states.
Thank you.
Time for one last question, if anybody has one. If not, maybe I'll ask it and just go, did you see changes in the time at which peak twist and untwist occurred?
Oh, that's a good question. I, off the top of my head, no, we didn't get any changes in the timings during twist and untwisting. Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much, Gavin. And again, timing is wonderful. So now you can relax and listen to the last presentation.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
And our last presentation is by Sam Weaver, who's from the University of Birmingham and who's going to talk about cerebral hemodynamics. So Sam, whenever you're ready, you can take it away.
Thank you very much for the introduction. So my name is Sam Weaver. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Birmingham, and today I'm going to discuss a study we carried out looking at how changes in acute exercise protocol to cerebral hemodynamics and neurotrophic factors in blood. So in terms of cerebrovascular trend exercise, we know that improvements in physical fitness improve cerebrovascular function, and that improved lifetime physical activity attenuates age-related decline in cerebrovascular function. And over an acute bout, the response we see in terms of cerebral blood flow is generally agreed to be in line with what we're likely to see in terms of chronic adaptation. And in a steady state situation, there's a well-established response profile with elevations in cerebral perfusion up to a moderate intensity and then declining thereafter, so that at maximal intensity, there's a reduction close to or back towards resting values. What's less well understood is how interval-based protocols may change this response. We know within the periphery, there is a change in response, so that exercise at higher intensities can drive similar adaptations to moderate intensity exercise, whereas continuous can't, whereas there's relatively little done within the cerebral vasculature. Kirtland et al. In 2017 showed that a single all-out sprint bout drove relatively little hemodynamic response, whereas Klein et al. In 2019 showed that if you carry out the same workload either as a continuous or interval-based protocol, relatively similar changes are seen. And so with that in mind, we look to examine the acute cerebral hemodynamic and circulating neurotrophic factor responses to three distinct and commonly utilized protocols, two from a clinical setting and one from an athletic training perspective, with the hypothesis that patterns in middle cerebral artery velocity, or MCAV, would differ between the conditions, with the smallest responses seen in the sit condition, similar to those seen under sprint interval training in the Kirtland study. At the same time, we wanted to look at neurotrophic factor responses that may drive neurovascular and cognitive benefits over a training period, as these haven't been studied in this context, and we believe that these would be intensity dependent. In order to do this, a group of 9 female and 15 male participants carried out 3 exercise protocols in a randomized order, consisting of moderate intensity continuous exercise, or MICT, which was 30 minutes of cycling at 65% of VO2 max, a HIIT protocol based on clinical guidelines of 4 4-minute efforts at 85% of heart rate max with a 3-minute active recovery between bouts, and 4 30-second sprint intervals at 200% of watt max with 4.5 minutes of recovery between. And then in all 3 conditions, the final bout was followed by 3 minutes of active recovery at 50 watts and a 15-minute seated passive recovery. Throughout all 3 sessions, we collected continuous measures of MCAV using transcranial Doppler ultrasound alongside continuous measures of end-tidal CO2. And we also collected blood samples at rest during the 2 interval protocols, at the end of all 3 protocols, and then at the end of the active and passive recovery periods. And these were analyzed for blood lactate alongside the neurotrophic factors, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, and insulin-like growth factor 1. For all measures, we carried out linear mixed effects with time and condition as fixed effects, and then used AIC assessment for the inclusion of sex and fitness based on whether they improved model fit. When we plot the data as a time course, averaged across participants, we see that over the 30-minute moderate intensity continuous protocol, we see an elevated MCAV that's maintained across the whole period. And then similarly in the HIIT condition, within the 4 bouts, we see a similar elevation in middle cerebral artery velocity, although we do see a decline in during the 50-watt active recovery. Whereas in the sick condition, we see relatively little response after this first bout, with a decline closer to baseline across all 3 of the latter bouts. Interestingly, we do see a rebound response, which I'll discuss in a moment. When we took 30-second averages across the course of each exercise protocol, we saw, as we saw in the time courses, that MICT and HIIT induced relatively similar responses in terms of MCAV, and these were coupled to similar responses in end-tidal CO2, with significant elevations across the course of both exercise protocols, suggesting that both would have a similar impact in terms of hemodynamic responses over the course of a chronic training period. However, in the SIT protocol, while this exercise bout 1 induced a similar elevation to the other 2 conditions in MCAV, in repeated bouts, there's a subsequent significant decline across all 3 bouts, and this decline continued into the active and passive recovery period, and at the end of the passive recovery period was significantly below what we saw in MICT and HIIT. And this was coupled to significant hyperventilatory hypercapnia across all bouts of SIT, and continued reductions in end-tidal CO2 from baseline in the active and passive recovery periods. When we explore this rebound phenomenon that we're seeing in the SIT condition, and we compare each exercise bout with the 30-second period immediately following recovery from immediately into the active recovery period, we can see that there's a significant elevation in middle cerebral artery velocity immediately following the sprint bout. And this was significantly different from the sprint bout itself in sprint bout 1. And whilst not significant in terms of MCAV in subsequent bouts, the rebound drove MCAV significantly above baseline when the bouts themselves were not significant. And similarly, we see responses in PET CO2 with a significant increase in end-tidal CO2 during this rebound period. What we don't know is whether or not this is driving similar benefits in hemodynamics. We know that continuous elevations in hemodynamics are likely important in terms of driving shear response adaptations in the vessel, whereas we don't know whether or not this short, sharp elevation in MCAV is sufficient to drive adaptive responses. We also don't know whether or not this sudden increase may pose risks, particularly in clinical populations, and this is something that needs further investigation. When we look at blood markers, starting with blood lactate, we see an expected response in all 3 conditions with a significant elevation following exercise. Similarly, we see an expected response in terms of intensity that this SIT condition drives significantly greater responses than either other condition. the active recovery elevations from baseline being fivefold greater than the active recovery point in either of the other conditions. Not only does this suggest that, does this demonstrate the higher intensity and potentially greater anaerobic demand of sprint-based exercise, it also suggests that there may be a benefit in terms of signaling responses, as lactate has been shown to interact with the blood-brain barrier in rodent models and drive neurovascular responses, and has also been shown to elevate the response in VEGF and BDNF. Moving on to those neurotrophic factors, again, the only significant response seen across all three neurotrophic factors was in the sit condition, with significant elevations over the course of the exercise protocol in both BDNF and vascular endothelial growth factor, suggesting that there's a significant increase in circulating signal factors in this condition alone. However, in IGF-1, we saw a significant suppression at the active recovery time point, which is unexpected given that in previous literature, IGF-1 has been shown to increase following high-intensity exercise. One potential explanation for this is we are seeing an elevation during the passive recovery or return towards baseline at passive recovery, and a similar pattern across the recovery period in the other two conditions, suggesting that it may be that we need a longer, later time point in order to detect this change in IGF-1, and that's something that needs further investigation. Interestingly, BDNF alone, following AIC assessment, suggested that the inclusion of sex differences should be incorporated into models. When we investigated these differences, we saw a significant difference between male and female participants in both the sit and mixed condition. In sit, we see a similar response profile in female participants with a significant elevation at the end of exercise maintained into the active and passive recovery period, whereas in male participants, we saw a significantly smaller response than in females and only significant elevations from baseline at the end of exercise. Interestingly, the MIC condition, in which we saw no response within the whole cohort, in the participants, we do see a significant elevation active and passive recovery with no response in the male participants. And this suggests that there is a potential sex difference and it requires further investigation in order to determine whether or not particularly the sit bounce may drive greater signaling responses in female participants than male. Also of interest is the fact there's no response in the HIIT condition, which again, is interesting because we would expect to see similar differences across all three conditions, particularly as we suggested it might be intensity dependent. One potential hypothesis around this is that you either need a prolonged steady state effort in order to accumulate sufficient BDNF or a very high intensity effort in order to accumulate BDNF, and that HIIT doesn't fall within any of these criteria. In conclusion, while similar acute hemodynamic responses are seen between the two clinical interval strategies, exercise strategies rather, sprint-based intervals drive relatively little hemodynamic responses while driving significantly greater changes in circulating factors. And as such, it may be that a combination of these approaches would be most beneficial when targeting future interventions, specifically targeting brain health. I'd just like to acknowledge my supervisors, Dr. Sam Lucas, Helen McGettrick, and Katerina Rendero, as well as the collaborators, research team, and undergraduates that helped with data collection on this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sam. I'm happy to take questions from the assessors. Jot in away. Go ahead, yes.
Thank you for a nice presentation. I was wondering, what is the relationship between the hemodynamic measurements and the neurotrophic factors, apart from the fact that these are both relevant parameters and happening in the same organ? Is there any link between those parts?
So there's no direct, there's not necessarily a direct link between the hemodynamic response we're seeing in the cerebral vasculature and the response we're seeing in neurotrophic factors. Our aim with this study was to investigate two potential avenues that may benefit the neurovasculature. And so we wanted to investigate both because we believe that there may be differences in the response between the two conditions, or three conditions rather. So there's no direct link, but the capacity for the vasoactive and circulating factors that are being released to act on both the endothelium and the brain are beginning to be better understood both in animal and cellular models. So the link is likely an adaptive chronic rather than the actual release from the endothelium per se.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Chatham.
Right. So I'd like to ask about the exercise intervention. So I agree with your choice of protocols, but do you know whether the volume of exercise was equivalent across the protocols?
So the volume of exercise wasn't equivalent across the protocols. It was relatively similar between MICT and HIIT, but there was a lower accumulation of total work done in the sick condition. The reason we chose to not match for workload is that in previous studies, four bouts of sit has been frequently used, and it's also increasingly seen in other studies. So our aim was to choose protocols that were being widely used rather than necessarily to match work rate. But the total work done was relatively similar between MICT and HIIT, just due to the higher intensity in the HIIT, despite the shorter time period.
So that wasn't the explaining factor for the lack of response in the HIIT for the big airflows?
No, so the responses were relatively similar in terms of total work done, which is what's led us to the hypothesis that it may be that you need a continuous exercise to accumulate enough release if it's at a lower intensity compared to the higher intensity sprint bouts.
Okay. And I was just wondering, where do you think the BDNF's coming from?
So BDNF's released from multiple sources. It's released from the skeletal muscle, and it is released from the brain, although there's conflicting evidence as to whether or not the responses we're seeing in the circulation are brain-released. It does appear, at least in terms of animal models, that the exercise induced changes in the circulation, although they're not entirely brain-derived. Do match the responses you see within cerebrospinal fluid. So they're systemic, the release, and so some of it will be cerebral, but some of it's also from skeletal muscle and other tissues.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just one from, go on, Jose, you've taken
off. Okay. No, but go ahead, Keith.
Okay, I was going to ask a question on your BDNF variability data. When you showed the whole cohort, Sam, there seemed to be a substantial amount of variability. And then when you showed the sex difference, it seemed to be all the variability was coming from the female participants. I'm just wondering if you've got any explanation as to why there's more variability in the females than there were in the males. Is it sample size? Is it hormones?
Yes, some of the variability will be sample size because there's only 9 female participants and 15 male participants. Also, the data we presented was as a fold change. So if there's relatively little change in male participants, we wouldn't expect to see a particularly large standard deviation. And yet there is likely a role of sex hormones. So this cohort weren't recruited at a particular point in the menstrual cycle because we didn't want to restrict the response we might see. We wanted free living female cohort. But there is definitely a need for future research to look at different points across the menstrual cycle to see whether or not that reduces the variability.
Okay, thanks. Go ahead, Jose.
I just wanted to ask you in regards to the measurement of middle cerebral artery flow, how representative are these of vertebral flow under all these three different exercise regimes?
So there is a likelihood that there's differences in actual flow compared to middle cerebral artery velocity across the three conditions, particularly in the sick condition. In the Kirtland study, they collected arterial blood pressure measures, and there is a significant spike in blood pressure during the all-out exercise bouts. This wasn't something we could do within this particular study, but we were aware of that limitation. But we believe because the end-tidal CO2 measures, which have been shown to be integrally linked to MCA, middle cerebral artery velocity, both in MRI and TCD. Those two matched reasonably consistently across all conditions and all time points. So there is certainly some likely differences in flow and vessel diameter, particularly in the sick condition as a result of blood pressure. But given the capacity for other methods to be used during exercise-based protocols, TCD was still our best option.
Okay, Sam, we've run out of time, so thank you very much for you and your presentation. My thanks to all of the presenters for very interesting and informative studies, very well presented in the format. It's obviously been a slightly different conference presentation experience for you. I hope you both, hope all of you have enjoyed the presentation process, and I hope you get to see some more of the conference as we move on. So thank you. We'll close the session now.